Okay, the next item of business is a statement by the Right Honourable Dorothy Bain KC on prosecution guidance on public safety and prison population. The Lord Advocate will take questions at the end of her statement, therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions, and I call on the Right Honourable Dorothy Bain KC, Lord Advocate, up to 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I am grateful for the opportunity to address the Chamber. Members have heard from the Cabinet Secretary that the prison estate in Scotland may imminently be beyond capacity. I understand that this is causing extraordinary pressure on staff as prisoner occupancy exceeds capacity in cells, undermining attempts to rehabilitate and reduce the danger posed by individuals, and presenting the risk that the prisons cannot take individuals into their custody. It is not for prosecutors to resolve the pressure on the prison estate, and prosecutors are ordinarily entitled to assume that there is sufficient safe capacity within the prison estate. But I have been asked what steps prosecutors, acting on my behalf, could take to alleviate some of the current pressures. I have concluded that it is possible and appropriate for me, acting independently and in the public interest, to provide further guidance to prosecutors while others implement longer-term steps to address this situation. The measures that I propose are temporary and will be kept under review. Before setting out these measures, there are some matters that I must make clear. Firstly, there will be no change to the current vigorous approach to the prosecution of domestic abuse and serious sexual offending in order to address the societal problem of violence against women and girls. It is essential that victims and the wider public understand that their allegations will be taken seriously. Secondly, I cannot say what the effect of the measures that I will outline may be in terms of additional prison spaces that may be created. That would be entirely speculative. Nor can I say whether any persons who are granted liberty as a result may reoffend, as that is similarly unpredictable. Thirdly, I am satisfied that prosecutors have been approaching the issue of whether to oppose bail on a consistent basis in accordance with law and in the public interest. The measures I have introduced are intended to impact in three situations. Firstly, those held on remand whose status may change on further review or through resolution. Secondly, those who may be liable to be remanded due to repeat offending or failure to appear, but who do not appear to represent an immediate risk to the public. And thirdly, preventing some offenders reaching the stage at which remand becomes necessary at all. In relation to those already on remand, initial decisions on bail are frequently made in short timescales based on relatively limited information and without immediate option of special conditions such as electronic monitoring or bail supervision. Bail reviews based on slower time social work assessments of the suitability of an individual for such conditions may provide a means to reduce the remand population. Such reviews cannot be initiated by prosecutors. They must be initiated on behalf of the accused. But prosecutors will endeavour to facilitate this process if approached and may also highlight potentially relevant cases for review to defence solicitors and local authorities. The grant of bail will remain a matter for the court. In relation to resolution, prosecutors must take steps to progress and resolve cases efficiently and swiftly. The requirement for and value of early and firm decision-making cannot be overstated. I have made it clear to prosecutors at all levels that effective early engagement with the defence is expected in all remand cases. We will build on the success of the summary case management pilot, which has shown significant increase in early disposals. We will work with our colleagues in the Criminal Defence Bar to proactively resolve cases earlier and reduce the time that accused persons may spend on remand. And in relation to those who may be liable to be remanded, judges make decisions about whether bail is granted. The prosecutor's role is to assist their decisions by highlighting risks based on information about the accused and the offence. Prosecutors start from the position that a person accused of crime should not be remanded in custody pending trial unless there are good reasons in law and the public interest to deprive them of their liberty. Bail will continue to be opposed where there is evidence to suggest the accused represents a substantial risk of causing harm to the public or victims and witnesses, and this risk cannot be mitigated by the imposition of bail conditions. When the issue of bail is first considered, prosecutors will highlight cases where they consider that the options of electronic monitoring or other means of monitoring special conditions of bail may manage the risk to public safety and prevent reoffending. Where individuals who do not represent a risk to members of the public or to specific individuals, my instructions to prosecutors is that bail should not normally be opposed. Where such offenders are not remanded in custody, there may be concerns about reoffending, but bail conditions will still be considered where they are likely to reduce the risk of reoffending. And where such individuals offend whilst on bail or breach special conditions of bail, these offences will be prosecuted. In addition, as a short-term measure, pre-conviction warrants should not normally be obtained and executed by the police, unless there is no immediate alternative to securing the accused's attendance or where the accused represents an immediate risk to others. Where attempts to secure the accused's attendance other than through the immediate execution of a warrant are unsuccessful, prosecutors may require the warrant to be executed. People accused of crime must know they cannot evade justice simply by not turning up at court without good reason and without consequence. In addition to prosecuting individuals for any offence of failing to attend, officials are currently considering how we can more readily proceed with trials in absence. I repeat, the existing approach to the initial grant of bail or after failure to appear will not change in relation to allegations of domestic abuse or sexual violence. And thirdly, in relation to early intervention, lower-level offending can quickly escalate to repeat offending, successive prosecutions, and often remand and imprisonment. There are three ways this is being addressed. Firstly, the consistent use of prosecutorial direct measures, along with my new guidance to the police on direct measures, may help to slow down this escalation. Secondly, escalated offending is a particular risk where the offender has an identifiable need, and that remains unaddressed. Prosecutors already make extensive use of diversion where there is an identifiable need that can be addressed through an available programme. I have reiterated my support for that approach, but it is, of course, dependent on the necessary programmes being available to address such needs. Thirdly, we continue to improve the information received from police to ensure that we secure the right outcomes for the right people. As an example, we now receive additional information from the police regarding mental health issues that may be relevant to the accused offending and personal well-being so that we can take informed views on decisions whether to prosecute or oppose bail. As Lord Advocate, my duty is to uphold the rule of law and to see that those who commit crimes are held accountable. No one is more determined than I am to see that people who need to be in prison are kept there. However, I recognise that the prisons are full beyond their capacity and will not deliver justice or public safety. The steps I have set out today, taken independently and in the public interest, will continue to serve to keep people safe. They will not change our robust approach to domestic abuse to protect women and children from the damage of domestic abuse, nor will there be any diminution in our approach to rape and serious sexual offences. They will serve to deliver a thoughtful and proportionate response in relation to the current pressures. Thank you.
Thank you. The Lord Advocate will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow up to 20 minutes after which we'll need to move on to the next item of business. And again, members wishing to ask a question who haven't already done so should press the request to speak buttons. I call first Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to the Lord Advocate for advancing out of the statement. Today, the public hoped for clarity over what would change in prosecution policy in response to our ballooning prison population. But instead, the Lord Advocate seems to want to make it harder to oppose bail and divert more offenders from prosecution in the first place. But clarity, there is little. The Lord Advocate says that although it's not her job to resolve prison pressures, her aim with these measures is to do just that. She then says she cannot say what the effect of these measures will be on prison spaces. Lord Advocate, what then is the evidential foundation for these specific measures being put in place? And secondly, we've just heard about this government's failure to prioritise and notify victims. Now, the Lord Advocate states it is unpredictable if those granted liberty may reoffend. Yet, given we know that interventions can be effective, has she worked with the government on these reforms to ensure that those interventions are in place and funded, or is she implementing these measures in a vacuum? And finally, the Lord Advocate concedes that she's done this in response to the full prisons. In other words, she would not have done this on her own volition, and therefore it is a less preferable course of action. So how does that fact square with her statement there will be no reduction in keeping the public safe?
Lord Advocate.
So there was a number of questions there, and I know that we're limited for time, but perhaps I could deal with some aspects of what has just been asked. As Lord Advocate, no one is more determined than I am to see that people who need to be in prison are kept there. It cannot be that we reach a stage where serious offenders are sentenced or remanded and there is nowhere for them to go because the space in prison is taken up by individuals who do not present an immediate risk to the public. Ensuring that communities are safe from the harm caused by crime is at the centre of what prosecutors do. This temporary measure, which I have explained, shifts the focus on how best that safety can be achieved. As I emphasised in my statement, the temporary measures will not change in relation to allegations of domestic abuse or sexual offences. The temporary guidance is to mitigate the current pressure on prisons. It will be reviewed. And I take my responsibility of my role very seriously. And a fundamental part of that responsibility is to serve the interest and to assist in the protection of the rule of law. In relation to the question asked about my role and engagement with the government of the day, I would say this, that the Scottish Government has legislated for a new test for bail, focusing primarily on the risk posed to the public and the complainer. That new legal test will come in force on the 1st of February. In the meantime, the existing test is set down by statutory provision in the 1995 Act, and it provides for an accused to be remanded only when the legal test is met and it is in the public interest to do so. Prosecutors are entitled to take into account the public interest in remaining and maintaining a safe prison estate when determining the Crown attitude to bail. It is critically important that it's understood that we are talking here today about prisoners who have not been convicted. These are pre-trial measures. They relate to bail and remand.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill.
I welcome the Lord Advocate's statement that prosecution policy on violence against women and girls and domestic violence will be as robust as it has been until now. Where the Lord Advocate says that those held on remand whose status may change on further review or through resolution, I wonder if the Lord Advocate could elaborate on what that means. A vital aspect of the criminal justice system is, of course, that summary justice is indeed summary, and it would be helpful if we had some understanding of the success of the pilot. The Lord Advocate has said that the Crown will work with the Criminal Defence Bar Association proactively to resolve cases earlier. So I wonder if the Lord Advocate could indicate to Parliament some of the current barriers that could be changed to ensure that summary justice is indeed summary.
Lord Advocate.
So in relation to the summary justice pilot, I think that that's a very large issue and involves complex considerations, and I'd be more than happy to talk to Ms McNeill about the success of the summary justice pilot and what we're doing to progress that across the whole of Scotland outside of today, and to share with her the enormous benefits that have come from the summary pilot by reason of close judicial management of cases, early engagement with the defence between Crown and defence, the early provision of evidence in each case, and the benefits for all involved in prosecutors' early engagement with victims of these crimes, is a combination of factors that have led to the enormous success of the summary justice pilot. And I would very much hope to see the combination of factors, including the excellent judicial management of cases that we've seen, for example, in Dundee, bearing the fruit that we've seen. So I can talk more about that today, but after today with Ms McNeill, and I'd be more than happy to share whatever information she wishes for. In relation to the use of bail reviews, we work with the colleagues in local authority social work teams and the Criminal Defence Bar to assist with bail reviews where possible. And any review undertaken by the Crown would be to identify those who may be suitable for a review of bail with conditions on a short-term measure to assist with the current pressure. The only reason reviews would take place is because of the gravity of the current prison conditions. We're, as prosecutors, not responsible for those, but we recognise that they're matters of considerable public interest, and decisions on bail are matters for the court. However, prosecutors will assist the court by providing information to help inform these decisions regarding potential conditions with public safety as a foremost consideration.
Thank you. I now call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This week, the Criminal Justice Committee discussed the temporary extension of time limits where people can be held on remand and which were put in place during the pandemic. Can I ask the Lord Advocate if continuing the extension will increase the pace at which cases progress, and therefore could this help reduce the numbers of prisoners remanded in custody?
Lord Advocate.
Thank you. Removal of the time limits presents a serious risk that victims and witnesses may be deprived of their access to justice. If the provisions are not extended, and in particularly immediately, if there were no saving provisions put in place, the Crown would require to make individual applications for extension of time periods for most cases currently in the system. That would mean that significant and critical resource would require to be diverted from preparing and prosecuting the most serious of cases in our criminal courts, and would involve a significant amount of work by all criminal justice partners. That process will simply compound delays and undo the good work that the criminal justice system has made in progressing the cases impacted by the COVID pandemic. It is likely that many of those accused would remain remanded if extensions are granted by the court, and indeed may receive a prison sentence, so would not result in a decrease in the prison population. I'm very happy to provide the member with further detail if that would be helpful.
Thank you. Sharon Dowie to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Lord Advocate for her statement, but I am struggling to see how this is going to make a difference to the prison population. I believe that her prosecutors are already trying to use diversion from prosecution rather than sending somebody to jail, but the issue is with prolific crimes where the only option is a custodial sentence. And, as she said in her statement, the necessary programmes need to be available. So can I ask the Lord Advocate, has she had a conversation with the Cabinet Secretary regarding the availability of these programmes and the extra funding that will be required for the criminal justice social work sector, whose workload would increase substantially?
Lord Advocate.
Thank you. It is right to say that there is an increased volume of criminal work coming through the system. And it's not solely related to the backlogs created by the COVID pandemic. There is an increase in significant criminal business coming through our system. I have been regularly briefed by both the Scottish Government and the Scottish Prison Service on the pressure on the prison population, including the impact of the Government's early release scheme approved by Parliament earlier this year. The Scottish Government has legislated for a new test for bail, focusing primarily on the risk posed to the public and the complainer, and that new legal test will come in February of next year. It is, however, clear to me that action is required pending that legislation, and I can only do so much. As Lord Advocate, I cannot change the law, but I can issue guidance as to the way that prosecutors should apply the public interest in their decisions in relation to the area that I can influence to any degree, which relates to bail and remand, and thereafter prosecution, conviction and sentence. I'm responsible for prosecution, conviction and sentence then falls on to the courts to administer. I can only do, as Lord Advocate, what I can.
Thank you. Ben McPherson, to be followed by Katie Clark.
As the Lord Advocate referenced in the statement, a reason that the remand population is very high is related to concerns that people will not turn up at court. Therefore, can the Lord Advocate say a bit more about what is being done to help ensure attendance at court and potentially undertaking trials in absence?
Lord Advocate.
So it is the case that an enormous challenge for the system can be the failure of individuals to attend court for their proceedings, particularly at summary level in the Sheriff Court. Prosecutors do all they can to ensure the attendance of accused through engagement with the criminal justice partners and engagement with the defence. But there's only so much that they can do in order to secure the accused's attendance through seeking warrants from the court and seeking the execution of these warrants by the police. So it is the case, though, in terms of culture of the prosecution service in Scotland, that the approach has never been to be proactively looking at trial in the absence of the accused. But this is something that we're going to have to look at very seriously in the whole circumstances that we're now dealing with in our criminal justice system, the pressures on the system and the pressures on the prison population. So it's something that prosecutors are looking at very seriously, and I can provide more information to the member, if he so wishes, after today about what's
Katie,
being done.
Katie Clark, to be followed by Claire Hawkey.
This Parliament has been persuaded on a number of occasions to extend the time limits in criminal cases, which of course means that many accused are spending longer on remand. After the emergency provisions, is she confident that these longer time limits are required in all cases? And how confident can she be in the longer term that we can reduce the length of time individuals spend on remand? And what can the prosecution services do to support this by speedily preparing cases?
Lord Advocate.
Yes. So thank you for the question. And I think some of what that was covered by the member was referred to by me in my response to Ms. Nicholls' question. It really is, in my view, important to understand the significant success that the Criminal Prosecution Service in Scotland has had over a very recent period in relation to the prosecution of serious sexual crime, domestic violence and serious organised crime. And I think that it's clear from the statistics available that the way in which these cases have been prosecuted and the success of the prosecution of these cases is one of the drivers for the increase in the prison population. But what we have to do is just to work our way through the situation as it now is. And the last thing we want is for people to be on remand for far too long a period. And the last thing we want is for cases to be taking longer than needs be because of the impact on victims and the impact on accused who are awaiting trial. But what we require to do is just work through where we're at and seek the extensions that are being sought with the current legislation. And I would hope that we continue to make progress by the challenges faced by the COVID pandemic and the increased level of business that's coming through the criminal justice system in Scotland.
Thank you. Claire Hawkey, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
I asked the Cabinet Secretary about the high levels of remand currently in our prisons, and I would ask similar to the Lord Advocate. Are you content that the 2,000 or so people currently on remand are all a risk to society?
Lord Advocate.
Yes. I'm satisfied that prosecutors have been approaching the issue of whether to oppose bail on a consistent basis in accordance with the law and in the public interest. The current test for bail does not require individuals to be a risk to society. My instruction to prosecutors is to focus on those who represent a substantial risk of reoffending and causing harm to individuals. Decisions on bail are a matter for the court. It is recognised, however, that while not determinative, the attitude of prosecutors to bail can have a bearing on the court's decision whether to detain someone in custody awaiting trial.
Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you. Prevention of crime produces better outcomes for everyone, and early intervention is a crucial component of this. The Lord Advocate spoke of the use of diversion and the importance of gathering good information from the police about mental health and other issues that may be relevant to an accused's case. Is the Lord Advocate aware of specific gaps in or barriers to accessing diversion programmes? And similarly, are changes in what information police officers gather required to better support prosecutors make informed views when deciding whether to prosecute or oppose bail?
Lord Advocate.
Yeah, so I'm aware of the recent statistics that show for 2023-2024 the number of diversion from prosecution cases commenced rose by 28% between 2022-23 to 2023-24, from 2,600 to 3,400. And it's important to note that this is the highest level in the last 10 years. And as we know, diversion from prosecution is a process by which prosecutors can refer a case to a local authority or other identified agencies as a means of addressing the underlying causes of offending. We do receive information that's relevant to these decisions, and prosecutors take these decisions with care, and they are informed about a particular individual's vulnerabilities through a variety of sources, including that from the police. And given the situation that we're in and the review of diversion that I'm currently undertaking, we are looking at whether or not the quality of the information that we receive from the police and through, for example, mental health services, whether or not that can be improved in order to inform the way in which we deal with diversion.
Thank you, Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased the Lord Advocate made clear that changes to the guidelines will not be applied to domestic abuse cases. Can the Lord Advocate provide reassurance that message will be effectively communicated to victims and their support agencies?
Lord Advocate.
Yes, so in relation to information for victims, we have spoken to a number of the victims' groups to reassure them that these temporary measures will not change the approach to cases of domestic abuse or sexual offences. A copy of this statement and supplementary briefing will be shared with Parliament victims' groups and published on the Crown Office external website so that victims and the wider public can access it. We will listen to any concerns raised and provide an update when we review the measures in January. I appreciate that there are consequences to these actions. Individuals who are not remanded for failing to appear may draw out the length of criminal proceedings in some cases, impacting witnesses, and this is not a decision taken lightly, but I do consider it necessary and proportionate in the current circumstances.
Willie Rennie, to be followed by Maurice Golden.
Justice social workers are essential for making community justice work. With their detailed knowledge of the offender, the circumstances, the range of custodial and non-custodial options available. Yet we hear that in a significant number of cases where social workers recommend non-custodial alternatives, the courts are, however, choosing instead to impose a prison sentence. Now, bearing in mind the independence of the judiciary, does the Lord Advocate recognise this situation, and what is her response to it?
Lord Advocate.
So I I don't have any knowledge of the situation that Mr Rennie has raised, and if you'd like to raise that with me directly after today, I can meet with him and talk it through. And I think the point to be made, though, is that decisions in and around ultimately bail and conviction and sentencing is a matter for the court, and that the, our judiciary in this country are independent, as is the prosecution service, in respect to which I am Lord Advocate. So these are separate roles that we have, and beyond that, perhaps an open discussion with Mr Rennie would be beneficial in these matters.
Okay, I'll look to take the final two questions, if they are brief in the responses. Likewise, Maurice Golden, to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Lord Advocate states she was asked to take steps to alleviate current prison pressures. When and by who?
Lord Advocate.
So, I have, as I've said, been involved in discussions about this issue with a variety of sources, and I pointed out that in relation to the timing of this statement, I have been regularly briefed by both the Scottish Government and the Scottish Prison Service on the pressure of the prison population, including the impact of the government's early release scheme. Specifically, in relation to the Scottish Prison Service, the Chief Executive has been in communication about the challenges with the Crown Agent, and there have been regular meetings with relevant policy officials, the Prison Service and the Scottish Government, with individual senior members of the Scottish Prosecution Service. Over and above that, individual prosecutors have visited Barlinnie and seen for themselves firsthand the challenges faced by the growing pressure on the prison population. And so it is in that context that I have been informed both by the government, but separately by the Prison Service and the Chief Executive of the Prison Service himself.
And Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've recently seen a 28% rise in the number of diversions offered. How does that contribute to reducing the remand population while also ensuring that our communities are kept safe? And are prosecutors sufficiently aware of the options that they have out with custody?
Lord Advocate.
So, in order to reduce the volume of cases coming into court, and to strengthen the prospects of addressing criminality at an early stage, the Crown has significantly increased its use of diversion, and it has the capacity to widen that if local authorities are able to provide diversion. There will be no change to existing policy in relation to individuals who present a risk of reoffending and harming an individual or members of the public. But I did last year instruct a review of how prosecutors deal with diversion from prosecution in cases of serious sexual offences such as rape. And that review, which engaged with victims, is reaching its conclusion. So what we do is to continue to monitor the use of diversion for cases involving domestic abuse, rape and attempted rape. And we continue to look at how diversion succeeds in relation to dealing with the underlying needs of an individual who has been brought into the criminal justice system. And so I think that it is recognised that if diversion works, it takes people out of the criminal justice system that can be so difficult for them to then rehabilitate from. And it's a way in which we can ultimately make communities safer and reduce the number of people who are actually progressing through the prison estate.
Thank you, Lord Advocate. That concludes this item of business. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.